Good evening, and welcome once again to the Emerald City. For those of you tuning in for the first time, I would like to make it clear that this is the world's first regularly scheduled television show aimed primarily at a gay viewing audience. We are coming to you from right here in the middle of New York City, where there are more gay men and women per square foot than possibly any place else on Earth. We have managed to develop a lifestyle that is both colorful and exciting, and plan on bringing you some of the best of it right here weekly. As I said in last week's show, we'll be using a magazine format. By this, I mean that there are several different departments on the program. There will be location sequences taped at some of New York's finest cabarets, a news report of goings on in the world of gay life, politics, civil rights, an interview with someone relevant to your interests, and a visit with our own George Sardi, the irrepressible, indescribable personality who is already becoming the talk of the town. We will also be bringing you messages from some of your friends in the gay business community. The cynics among you will refer to these as commercials, and for the most part they are. I might add that this show's continuance is dependent on them. Unlike commercials on regular TV, these will be for the first time aimed at you as a gay consumer, and I feel that you'll find many of them quite interesting. On tonight's show, you'll be seeing an interview with Enid Gerling, noted defense attorney, longtime protector of gays. She'll be joined by Mr. Chuck Ortleb, publisher of Christopher Street Magazine. We'll visit the grand finale nightclub where Mr. Waylon Flowers and Madam have them rolling in the aisles nightly. Later, it's on to the Barbaran Theater for a look at the review Starting Here, Starting Now, a show which some critics say is the best musical cabaret in town. Later, George Sardi will be here with the news from God knows where. And newscasters Harry Hart Brown and Darlene Lyon will give you the latest on orange juice from Florida and other news. We would like to hear from you. We are truly interested in what you think of this program and its contents. Write or call us at the number which will be appearing on your screen shortly. And most importantly, if you want to see the show continue, tell our sponsors that you saw their ads here, because after all, that's the only way that they'll know that you're watching. Again, let us hear from you. We're waiting. As I said last week, performers appearing on the Emerald City are not necessarily gay. Thank you. From the Barbaran Theater Restaurant, Starting Here, Starting Now.
You're the girl of the minute, as tiny as now, and in every conceivable way. Your face seems to capture this instant in time. You're the young pulsing
from the Barbara Ann Theater Restaurant. I wish you a great good afternoon. The show is starting here, starting now. The songs, Richard Maltby Jr. and David Shire. With me are, from left to right, Miss Marjorie Cohn. Marjorie? Yes.
Yeah.
Ronnie Ackerman and George Leanders. Okay. Ronnie, I want to ask you something first. How do you, are you from New York?
Yes.
I figured it out because, I mean, how else could you articulate those lyrics so fast and talk to us?
New York is not articulate.
It's stone, do I mean?
They wine.
It's not really wine.
And dine.
And dine.
No, but I mean, the words are so fast and the pace is so quick. Is that a result of Mr. Maltby writing process?
Yeah, it's every day.
Thank you.
This show been open here. Any of you all original cast members?
No, he's the original George.
And the second original. George. On the subject of George. You have appeared in a lot of night music.
A lot of night music.
Let me see. Also, Hal Prince got selected to direct the show in South Africa. Was that a total surprise to you, or did you know that was coming?
No, I didn't know it was coming until he told me, and then I knew.
And how long were you there?
I was there for 4 weeks.
George, yes. I admire the unique. You were married atop a mountain in Colorado?
Yes.
You gotta tell me something about that. What sparked that?
A mountain?
Yes.
Well, I figured it was time to get married, and so I thought the best place to do it would be out in the open air.
Uses the microphone.
So we
did you know that in the beginning? Why? In the beginning,
very loud.
Well, the reviews are all accurate, so it's got to be seen to be believed. From the Barbara Ann Theater Restaurant, Marjorie Jones, Lonnie Ackerman, George Lee Andrews, the reviews starting here, starting now, songs by Richard Murphy Jr. and David Child. This is Frank O'Dowd. Good night from Emerald City.
Bye.
Hi, I'm Darlene Lyne.
And I'm Harry Hart Brown, and here's the news. The first time in history the gay people have been granted a meeting in the White House has turned into a second time, and a third time is in the works. In the Roosevelt Room last week, the Carter administration agreed to set up a series of meetings between gay representatives and a variety of federal agencies and departments. This, of course, stemmed from the meeting last January held between Carter aide Midge Costanza and National Gay Task Force co-directors Gino Leary and Bruce Vello. Reactions to this recent meeting sound more than a little encouraging. Gino Leary said it was really great. Midge Costanza said it was marvelous. A Democratic Party aide commented that the gay contingent has been the most professional and the most well-organized group that has come to the White House since the Carter takeover. And Carter Press Secretary Jody Powell said the meeting showed what America is all about. Oh, I have another comment here from our friend Anita Bryan, and I quote, "I protect the action of the White House in dignifying these activists with special privilege for a serious discussion of their alleged human rights." End of quote. The follow-up meeting is planned for September.
On the subject of civil rights, it's interesting to note that groups opposing gay civil rights are inevitably allied with groups opposing the Equal Rights Amendment for women. Lynn Yates Carter, one of the coordinators of the ERA drive, said this week, "Gay women have a vested interest in the ERA. It would enforce their rights as women and would be a step towards asserting the rights of the individual."
Robert L. Livingston has become the first openly gay member of New York City's Human Rights Commission. The group, headed by Eleanor Holmes Norton, is concerned with problems concerning the human rights of citizens of New York City. Livingston is chairman of the Fund for Human Dignity and a member of both the National Gay Task Force and the Gay Rights National Lobby. Formerly a Broadway and network television producer, as well as publisher of the journalism review More, Livingston was appointed to the commission by Mayor Bean. Upon assuming his new responsibilities, Mr. Livingston said, "I don't want to be known as the gay human rights commissioner, but rather as the commissioner who also happens to be gay."
In Los Angeles this week, a new group of gay professionals and business people has set up the LA Community Guild. They held their first formal dinner and announced plans to raise funds for the Gay Retirement Center. This group now joins New York's Greater Gotham Business Council, the East Coast group of gay professionals and businessmen. Greater Gotham has a membership of 150 and meets monthly to install new members and to discuss matters of mutual interest.
Jonathan Katz, author of Gay American History and the play Coming Out, a recent interview guest on the Emerald City, is not alone in his chosen discipline. The first gay history workshop was recently organized at the convention of the American Historical Association in Washington. Over 60 participants attended the workshop, which was entitled Homosexuality in History.
You may find it interesting to note that in a recent story reported on this program by Cheryl Gross, she spoke of the seemingly liberal attitudes of the people in Boise, Idaho, in allowing a foot fetish convention to take place. Well, it now seems that the people are not all that liberal after all. Boise's first female police officer, along with three other city employees, were dismissed recently as a result of rumors that they were lesbians.
And now we come to the Dade County Affair, starring Anita Bryant. For those of you who need some background, Ms. Bryant is spearheading a drive in South Florida to repeal Dade County's Gay Civil Rights Ordinance. She has succeeded in scheduling a special referendum vote on June 7th. Her position basically is that homosexuality is immoral and illegal, and that condoning it in law will lead to perversion of the children. Many in Florida see a connection between this movement and the Stop ERA movement, which is currently boiling there as well. More alarming is the developing rift within the gay community on tactics in fighting Ms. Bryant. Some conservative gay groups insist that by attacking the Florida Citrus Commission, her employer, gays are adopting the same tactics she's using. Less conservative gay groups feel that attacking the commission is the only way to fight her. Get her in the pocketbook where it hurts is their feeling. If we care to do anything about this, we can. Dade County Coalition of Gay Groups needs financial support as well as moral support. If anyone out there is moved to express themselves in any way whatsoever, they may send a contribution or correspondence, and I'll give you the address, to Miami Victory Campaign, Box 1976, Miami Beach, Florida, and the zip is 33139. And that's Miami Victory Campaign, Box 1976, Miami Beach, Florida. Zip is 33139. Or you can call the area code 305-751-GAYS. And that's the news. This is Harry Hart Brown.
This is Darlene Lyons.
Good night.
Good night.
Hello? Florida calling. It's not collect, is it? Okay. Put her on. Hello. Who? Anita who? I'm sorry. There's a bad connection here. I can't understand. I don't understand what the... Who? Cheryl? A sewing machine? Well, I don't even cook. Who am I talking to? Anita. You sound like you've got a mouthful of... Oh, sisters. That Anita. Chitty. Hello. Never news, you're starting. Well, I hope I look better this time. Because the last time I was in Met, I asked a huge cross across the lens
and they get an oilcloth instead. Not only do they wipe out the line, they wipe out the face. Now, unfortunately today, the meteorologist, is out sick. He has foot and mouth disease, multiple sources in the valve. So therefore, they've given me the duty to do. I've never done this before. Well, let me see. Oh, yes. There's something brewing in Anheuser-Busch, St. Louis, be it a gale, storm, or blizzard. I guess with this one, you have a multiple story. That's strange. And there's still an awful lot of hot air surrounding Washington, D.C. As would you believe, it's still lightning and thundering in Sodom and Gomorrah. And I understand everyone there now has gone on the salt-free diet. Very sensitive. And they're still getting a snow job in Siberia. And in Texas, they're getting a big blow job. Yes. In Texas, they're getting a big blow job by Hurricane Harry. That meteorologist is very strange. I think they better go back to an old-fashioned weatherman. What the hell is this? Oh, that girl, I guess she's gimping down the old yellow brick road. Well, let's go on to a little dish. It seems that in Joan Rivers' act, she says Italians are the sexiest men. But have you ever seen a homosexual Italian? The minute they go gay, they make them nuns. Now, really, Joan, there's far too intelligent for that. And Vanessa Redgrave says there's nothing so special about bisexuality. After all, it's as old as the British Empire. Well, let's hope the Grecian one too, dear. And in San Francisco, the gays' official entry in last year's Rose Parade was an upright loaf of French bread in a basket. Well, the parade officials X-rated the thing and altered its appearance for the TV camera. What'd they do? So in a bagel? Well, David Cope is out doing his thing for his book, The David Cope Story, and is a big smash. He's being swamped by women all over the country, and you can read it. Excerpts in his book now, The Woman Today Book Club, as well as Playboy's Book Club, and The Cosmopolitan Girl is reading it today. Ooh, wow. Anyhow, stripper, male porno star, Jack Wrangler, who takes off his shoes at the duel and does a desert monologue with it, claims to be the son of Dolores Gray. He is soon to appear in Butterflies in Heat, a hustler story about the keys written by Darwin Porter, and in it will be Gloria Fulton and George Bizarre. Well now, mock superstar Lily Tomlin is host of the town, was testing the comedy talents of Nancy Belt. Oh my dear Nancy, how lucky can you be? And tennis star Bobby Riggs gave members of the Racquet Club in Palm Springs something to talk about when he recently played a game with Renee Richards. Love anyone? Good night, girlfriend.
Good night, man.
Good evening. My name is Chuck Ortlieb, and I'm the publisher of Christopher Street Magazine. And with me tonight is Enid Gerling, who's an attorney in Manhattan, practicing on a number of different kinds of court cases. But tonight we're going to focus on some of the cases that gay people, I think, are very interested in, and that's her entrapment cases. We won't be talking about any entrapment cases that are going on now, because there aren't any in Manhattan, at least as far as we know. But we'll be talking about cases that have been heard or tried in the 50s. And this is the kind of nostalgia that gay people don't like to hear about too much. But it could be quite interesting. How did gay people find out about you in the 50s?
Oh, you're making me feel old. Let's say it's in the 80s and make it that way. I was originally assigned the attorney in the court. It seemed they assigned different lawyers different cases, and the men lawyers took advantage of the gay kids that were being arrested for entrapment cases. So the judges just threw everything at me, and that's how I got those papers.
What do you mean, what do you mean they took advantage?
Well, I used to ask them too, they asked some big fees. I never took proper care of them. I used to take pleas of guilty before they even talked to them. They found out they had no money.
Right.
They didn't properly interview them. They didn't have any compassion for them. They had contempt for them. So the men judges got to a point where they used to sign me to all the gay cases, and that's how I got them.
Do you remember your first gay case?
Yes, I do, as a matter of fact. My first gay case was a very prominent man in New York, whose name, of course, I won't mention. And when I asked him my big fee, which is incidentally very small next to what he would have paid, he wrote the check out very fast. When we got in front of the judge, who's now dead, who is Judge Bushell, I remember he asked his name, and when his name came out, he said, "Who's your mother?" And he told him, he said, "Who's your aunt?" And he told him, he says, "Get the hell out of here, case dismissed." It was his cousin. That was my first gay case.
Well, all of your gay cases weren't quite that easy, were they?
Well, I'll tell you something. I found that I think I lost two or three in about 1,000, 1,500. I found that if you could make the judge laugh, most judges, and educate them towards how the gay people were being entrapped,
right.
Most of them were very sympathetic, so you could steer it into a dismissal.
Right. How were gay people being entrapped in the 50s?
Well, mostly they would raid bars, and they wanted to close the gay bars, and when they raided a bar, they'd stand around and pick up five from a bar and then send it down to the state liquor authority.
Right.
And I remember one particular bar, they gave a birthday party. And the birthday party, then they circulated among all the gay boys, and one officer testified that the man said he was very handsome, and the judge leaned over and said, "I hope you didn't believe it." But that's how they entrapped him. It was pure entrapment. And they always picked on people that were drinking martinis.
Why martinis?
I don't know. I made more money with martinis than any other drink.
When I think of entrapment, I often think of bathrooms and two-way mirrors.
Well, most of the bathrooms were when two people contributed.